Well, Mitsubishi has pretty much fallen off of the performance car market entirely in the US. Back in the 1990s, they had a lot of great options, namely the Eclipse, Galant, and the Evo. The engine which powers those vehicles is the 4G63, which we've done a video on in the past. Since we've released that video, a lot of you guys have asked for a video comparing the 4G63 and the 4G64. After all, both of them are from Mitsubishi and both of them are from the same engine family, and there's a lot of similarities and a lot of differences. So grab some popcorn and hold on tight, because today we're going to compare the 4G63 and the 4G64 and find out which one is better. Before we dive in too far, we should cover some of the very basic stuff. Now, if you didn't know, both the 4G63 and the 4G64 are part of Mitsubishi's Sirius engine family, which started all the way back in 1976, and it's still in production today. It's important to note that a lot of the vehicles that are currently using anything from the Mitsubishi Sirius engine family are not from Mitsubishi itself. There are a lot of Chinese automobile manufacturers who rely on Mitsubishi's Sirius engine family. One of those being Great Wall Motors, who uses it in a few of their vehicles. That being said, Mitsubishi still does use the Sirius engine family in their modern vehicles. However, they only use it in a select handful of vehicles, and it's not something you're going to find in a large amount of different applications. The 4G63 specifically started all the way back in 1980, and it's still being used by a handful of Chinese companies today. The 4G64, on the other hand, started in 1983, and it's still being used by some Chinese auto manufacturers. In case you were curious, the naming convention includes 4 for the number of cylinders, G for gasoline, 6 refers to the engine family, and the final number refers to the engine itself within that engine family. And if it's a turbocharged model, such as the 4G63T, it'll have a T at the end, which stands for turbocharged. I would list off all the applications that use the 4G63 and the 4G64, but there's an absolute ton of them. So instead of boring you, I'll list it down in the description for those of you who are curious what applications use these two engines. Now, with the basic stuff out of the way, let's look a little bit more in depth at both of these engines. Starting with the 4G63, we've got a 2-liter displacement, an 85mm bore, and an 88mm stroke. Some dual overhead cam and some single overhead cam engines, a really strong cast iron block. Some variants feature Mitsubishi's MyVec variable valve timing system, and some of them are turbocharged. The earliest 1-gen DSM engines are known as 6-bolt engines because of their 6 bolts holding the flywheel to the crankshaft. Later 4G63 engines are known as 7-bolt engines. It's important to note that there are a significant amount of differences between the 6-bolt and the 7-bolt 4G63s, but most of the differences revolve around the rotating assembly. If you want to know more about 6-bolt versus 7-bolt, check out the 4G63T video, which we did a while back, which explains this a lot more in depth. Now, looking at the 4G64 compared to the 4G63, the biggest and most obvious difference is displacement. Where the 4G63 is a 2-liter engine, the 4G64 is a 2.4-liter engine, although technically it only has 2,351 cc's, so it's a 2.35-liter, but we rounded up to 2.4-liter because reasons. The increase in displacement was mostly achieved through increasing the stroke to 100mm, but bore was also increased to 86.5mm, which is just slightly bigger than the 4G63's bore. Aside from the increased displacement, the blocks of the 4G63 and the 4G64 are incredibly similar, including the fact that there are 6-bolt and 7-volt variants of the 4G64, just like there are the 4G63. The differences between the 6-bolt and 7-volt 4G64 are pretty much the same between the 6-bolt and 7-volt 4G63, which is a lighter rotating assembly because the original earlier engines had a very heavy rotating assembly, which results in a really inefficient engine. Another important distinction is the fact that the 4G64 has a 6mm higher deck height, and this is important to note because, as we're going to talk about later on, a lot of people like to swap around blocks or swap around cylinder heads, and that 6mm can make quite a bit of difference. Now, what's really interesting is that these engines are so incredibly similar that you can interchange a lot of the parts to give yourself a unique engine. And what I mean by this is that you can take a 4G63 block and use a 4G64 crank with stock 150mm connecting rods and an offset piston to build a 2.3-liter stroker motor. You can also do the opposite and put a 4G63 crank inside of a 4G64 block to create a 2.1-liter destroked 4G64. Now, the important thing to note is that if you're swapping around cranks, it needs to come from the same generation engine. What I mean by this is that if you're swapping a 4G63 crank into a 4G64 block or the other way around, you need to be swapping 6-bolt parts into 6-bolt engines or 7-bolt parts into 7-bolt engines. Both engines came with either a single overhead cam or a dual overhead cam cylinder head. And for the most part, the heads on both engines are pretty similar and mostly interchangeable. You can even fit a 7-bolt head on a 6-bolt engine or the other way around with some minor work. Not too surprisingly, the dual overhead cams are significantly better than the single overhead cams in pretty much every single way. So if you're trying to build a high horsepower motor, a dual overhead cam head is definitely going to be the better option, whether you're running a 4G63 or a 4G64. Internally, these engines are incredibly similar, but there are some notable differences. course, the crank, pistons, and rods are slightly different, and most notably, the 4G64 has an overall higher compression ratio. There are different compression ratios throughout the variants, but for the most part, the 4G64 is going to have a higher compression ratio. This is important to note because if you wanted to turbocharge a 4G64 instead of buying a 4G63T, you're going to need to run lower compression pistons because that higher compression ratio is going to lead to piston knock. There are a lot of really small differences that we could dive into, but all of them are pretty insignificant. And realistically, the naturally aspirated 4G63 and the naturally aspirated 4G64 are incredibly similar. Really, the biggest difference comes down to the fact that the 4G64 has more displacement. Now, if you were to look at a 4G63T compared to a 4G64, there are a lot of differences because the 4G63T is beefed up for that forced induction application. Realistically, the 4G63T was designed as a race engine for use in Mitsubishi's Rally Racing Ventures, and it's arguably one of the best turbocharged four-cylinder engines ever produced. If you were to look at this from a high level and answer the question of which one is better, it really depends on the specifics. If you were just looking at naturally aspirated engines, the 4G64 is arguably better because it has more displacement, which means more low-end torque and more drivability on the street. Now, if you were to compare 4G63T versus 4G64, it's pretty obvious that the 4G63T is a better engine because it has a turbocharger straight from the factory. It makes a lot more power, has a better bottom end, and it makes a lot more torque, and it's a lot more tunable. If you were to compare what these engines are capable of and not what they do in stock form, arguably, the 4G64 is better solely for that increased displacement. But if you want a really high horsepower and really reliable engine, a lot of people resort to either building a de-stroked 4G64 or a stroked out 4G63. Also, a lot of people just simply take a 4G64 and put a 4G63T head on it to build basically the best of both worlds and have the most displacement possible while also being turbocharged. Now, if you're just straight up comparing 4G63 versus 4G64, the 4G63 is arguably better because it has a factory turbocharged variant, which is the 4G63T. Now, if you're comparing naturally aspirated engines, the 4G64 is arguably better because it has more displacement, which means more low-end torque. If you guys think there's anything I missed or if there's anything you want to add, please put it down in the comments below and let me know. I'm not perfect and sometimes I will miss something important when researching both of these engines. So if there's anything I missed, please let me know down in the comments below. That way we can all have an informed discussion. While you're down there, be sure to hit the thumbs up button and subscribe so you don't miss out on future videos. Hit that little bell icon so you get notifications when I upload videos, and I'll see you guys in the next one.